Hello everyone. Hope you're having a great day. Survived that big snowstorm that came through, but wasn't too bad. Anyway, we're here at the church. We just got finished recording some for our Christmas program. Be sure and check that out. It'll be available on Friday online. I think you're really gonna enjoy it. There's lots of good music and a good story, good funny story that I think you'll really enjoy and warm your heart this Christmas season. But today I wanna share with you another one of my favorite Christmas stories. It's called The House That Glowed by Arthur Maxwell. It's another old story, and I think you'll enjoy it. It was Christmas Eve, and poor little John, driven out of his home by an angry and brutal stepfather, was trudging wearily through the snow. His ragged coat was sodden and melted snow. His shoes were split at the seams so that his feet were damp and numb with cold. His quaint cap, pulled well down over his ears and forehead, had a gaping tear that let in the biting wind. Night was falling, and the gathering darkness found the little homeless boy still plodding on his sad and lonely way. If only I could find some shelter, some place where I could get warm and the wind would not chill me, so he thought to himself. If only someone would give me some food to eat and something hot to drink. Coming to the edge of the forest, he caught sight of a little village nestling in the valley below. Several fine, large houses dotted the hills around it. Lights were already twinkling in the windows, while the smoke from many chimneys curling upward blended with the murky sky. A great new hope sprang up in little John's heart. Here at last, among so many lovely homes, he would surely find someone to care for him. He walked more quickly, certain that his troubles were almost over. Soon he came to the entrance of a big, fine mansion. There were many lights on in the windows and a very bright one over the front door. Surely, he thought, people who could live in such a house must have lots of money and would be only too pleased to help a poor, hungry little boy. Very bravely, he walked up to the front door and by standing on tiptoe managed to reach the bell. He pushed it hard and there was such a noise inside that it frightened him. But he was more frightened still when the great oak door was thrown back and a big man dressed in a fine blue and gold uniform looked out at him. "Did you ring that bell?" asked the haughty butler, frowning. Yes, stammered John. I'm very cold and hungry, and I thought you..." "This is Christmas Eve," snapped the butler, "and the house is full of guests. I'm sorry, but we don't have time to bother with the likes of you just now. Good night." And the door was shut. "Oh," said John to himself, "I never thought anyone would do that, but perhaps they are too busy here. I must try somewhere else." So he walked on down into the village itself, passing by the other big mansions for fear the people inside might also be too busy to care about a hungry little boy on Christmas Eve. From the first house he reached there came sounds of music and laughter. "These people will be friendly," he thought as he knocked gently on the door. But there was so much noise inside that he had to knock again and again, each time louder than before. At last, the door swung open and a young man wearing a funny paper cap looked out. "Excuse me," said John, "but I wondered if you could..." "Sorry," cried the jovial young man. "We're having a great Christmas Eve party in here and we can't stop now." "But please, please," pleaded John. "Sorry, good night," cried the young man, and bang, the door was shut. Terribly disappointed, John went next door, but the people there were making so much noise that they didn't even hear him at all, loud as he knocked. At the next house, a crabby old gentleman looked out an upstairs window and told him to run home and not bother the neighbors. Run home indeed. At another house, he was told to call again another day. They would help him then, perhaps, and the people said, but he needed help now. So going from house to house through the entire village, he sought shelter and food and found none. Almost hopeless and heartbroken, he trudged on into the night, leaving the twinkling lights behind him. He felt he could lie down and die in the road. He was so tired, so hungry, so discouraged. Just then he happened to look up and found himself passing a tiny, tumble-down old cottage, so dark and dismal that he probably wouldn't have seen it at all, but for the white carpet of snow on the ground showing it up. A blind, almost covered the one window, letting a faint streak of light show through at the bottom. John stood still and wondered what he should do. Should he knock here? What would be the use? Surely if the people who lived in all the big houses, who had money for lovely parties and things, couldn't afford to help a poor boy, how could the folks in a house like this? No, it was no use. Better not bother them. Better go on and just die in the woods. Then he thought again. He had knocked at so many houses, there could be no harm in trying one more. So he turned from the road up the snow-covered garden path and tapped gently on the door. A moment later, the door opened cautiously, and an elderly woman peered out. "Bless my soul," she exclaimed. "Whatever are you doing out there in the cold tonight?" "Please," began John, but before he could say another word, she had flung the door wide open and dragged him inside. "You poor little child," she exclaimed. "Deary, deary me, you look so cold and hungry. Half starve, or I'm mistaken. And wet clear through. Let's get those things off at once. Wait a moment while I stir up the fire and put the kettle on." John looked about him and saw that the little one-room cottage was as bare as could be, without even a carpet on the floor. The light he had seen came from one lone candle set on the mantelpiece. But he hadn't time to see much else, for the kind woman was soon stripping off his wet rags and wrapping him in a blanket and setting him up at the table before a bowl of steaming soup. Then she went back to stir the pot on the stove. As she did so she suddenly noticed that something strange was happening. She looked up. Was it a dream, or were her eyes deceiving her? The candlelight had given place to a warm and lovely glow that seemed to be getting brighter every minute, filling every corner of the cottage with a heavenly radiance. Every drab piece of furniture seemed to be shining and glistening like burnished gold, as when God filled the temple with his glory. And the rich man, looking down from the mansion on the hill, suddenly exclaimed, "There's a strange light in the valley. Look, Widow Greatheart's cottage is on fire." The news spread swiftly from house to house, and soon all the merry parties were abandoned as the people, wrapping themselves up in their coats and shawls, rushed out to see what was the matter. They saw the light too, and running towards the widow's cottage, beheld the poor, tumble-down old building glowing like an alabaster bowl. Very excited, they gathered around it. Peering inside, all they could see was the dear old woman caring for the very same little boy who had called that night at so many of their homes. Then, as the light faded, they knocked on the door to ask anxiously what could have happened. "I really don't know," said Widow Greatheart, with a smile of wondrous joy and satisfaction on her face. "I just seem to hear a voice saying to me, 'Inasmuch as you have done unto one of the least of these, my children, you have done unto me.'" I love that. Good. It's just a special little story. So heartwarming. A lady who just, Widow Greatheart, just opened her heart to a little boy, and something special happened. Well, let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this season. We thank you for Jesus coming. And Lord, help us to do what we can for others that are around us, that we can serve you by serving them. And help us, Lord, in the days ahead to just take opportunity to do that, to open our homes, open our hearts. Maybe opening our homes isn't a great idea these days, but we can certainly open our hearts and do something for someone that might be struggling this Christmas season. Just give us hearts that are warmed to you. Lord, continue to help us as we deal with the coronavirus. Lord, we lift up those that are dealing with it, those that have it, those that are waiting to hear from tests. Be with doctors and nurses and first responders. Lord, just surround them with your love, with your peace, with your courage. Just help them, Lord, each and every day as they help all the rest of us. Keep them safe, Lord. Just help them. Lord, just continue to be with us in this Christmas season. Things are different, but we can still find ways to worship you, to glorify your name. Lord, just make that clear to us what we can do. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, thanks for watching today, and we'll be back tomorrow with another good Christmas story. Have a great rest of your day. Bye-bye.